back on your television on New Day here on TV3. Trust you're enjoying the show. Thank you to Jen Spark for my necktie, my lapel pin, and my pocket square as well. And they're on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. You can get some for yourself. Very lovely. Now, let's start the newspaper review segment. And we start with a daily statement today that says, Galamseyers are killers. That's the banner headline. And government suspends licenses for small-scale mining. We support your vision. World Bank assures President Akufo-Addo. Vigilantes can turn terrorists. Nigerian professor cautions on the front page of the Ghanaian Times. And government to use vessel monitoring system to check illegal fishing and make fiscal discipline top priority. World Bank Vice President tells President Akufo-Addo. Media's crusade against Galamsey kicks off. It started yesterday. The Daily Graphic this morning says media declare war on Galamsey and 7 Chinese, 3 Ghanaians arrested for illegal mining. We support your vision. One more time, the World Bank and Cote d'Ivoire angry with Ghana for polluting its waters. Frimpong Boateng, professor for a minister for environment, science and technology and innovation, says so. The Daily Guide this morning says Princess Anne meets Nana and Melbourne sues client for contempt. Well, NDC is broken, car, says Dr. Ekospio Gabra. The Finder newspaper says BDC's cry foul against government's unfair practices. Ex gratia lawyer storms court, Supreme Court. That is, World Bank backs Nana's vision and government pledges to fight cybercrime. The Independent newspaper this morning says we support your vision. World Bank VP tells President your task is difficult. Akufo-Addo to new Bank of Ghana governor and President Mahama pays gets a call on GNT members. And Daily Heritage was our final newspaper for today. It said big boost for fishing industry as government acquires research vessel for Ghana. Sankofa Akwesia Pia is back as Black Stars coach after Brazil fiasco. State institutions under heavy security after attack on NHIA by invisible forces. My guest this morning is Alhaji Umar Al Hassan. He is the MP for Zamzugutata. Honorable, welcome.
Thank you.
Good morning. How are you doing?
Pleasure.
How is Parliament thus far? Is the Speaker ready to speak on the bribery allegation here?
Very well. Well, we're still waiting on the Speaker's. That's his prerogative, and maybe before Parliament comes to a recess, he will give his ruling.
That's Friday.
That's Friday.
Okay.
Hopefully Friday, but we wanted to even if the.
But you don't know why there seemed to be some pussyfooting around the place. The report was late. The leadership debated it. We expected that a verdict would have been run at this point.
You know, even though I'm new in Parliament, but the activity and procedure in Parliament is very different.
Right.
It's his authority and it works on its own. So if you're outside Parliament, you wouldn't understand.
Right.
So, and it's
that make us understand. Well, Mr. Philip Lanting is a member of the MPP, is part of their communications team as well. Chief, welcome. Good morning to you. How are you doing?
I'm all right.
Interesting. Let's start off with the Nigerian professor who says, if we don't ban the vigilante groups, they will become terrorists. And I'm linking this in connection with the Delta Force, the invisible forces in the Eastern region. It comes right in the back of the president's admonition that don't do it, stop. He's been telling the IGP, go and act. And yet, we're not seeing any action, really. Are we in trouble, Mr. Lanting?
Well, thank you very much. And good morning. Good morning to my colleague. And also good morning to our viewers. The professor from Nigeria is... the advice he gave in principle is not too far from the truth. But let us acknowledge first and foremost that all over the world, vigilantes, or what we call vigilantes, you have groups of people who help. We've had our neighborhood watch groups. We've had various groups. The problem is when these groups begin to go beyond bounds.
Right.
You see, that is a problem. First of all, they're a human institution. So it can be expected that sometimes you may have an element of two among them who may go beyond what is necessary, what is required, or what is legal.
Okay.
And then also there are some too who might come under the guise of some of these things, who themselves may have their own criminal inclinations or whatever. So that's another matter. Now, there's two things. The most important issue is that His Excellency the President has made it very clear his position on these matters. No illegality, lawlessness, indiscipline is going to be accommodated. Mm. So that has been stated. He has encouraged the police to go ahead and go about their legally, you know, constitutionally mandated responsibility.
Right.
So that one is clear. There's no two ways. So that is the backdrop of the situation. Now, what the professor is saying, he was making specific reference.
Exactly. To Boko Haram.
To the situation in Nigeria and how, you know, the genesis of Boko Haram. Which started as a group of people who had some political sympathizers. And then they were, as it were, abandoned by their sponsors and then went into not just criminality, but they went into evil.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So that is the caution he has given, which in itself is true. But the difference is that here in Ghana, we are, the president himself has taken the position that we're going to deal with this. We're not going to allow this to
How soon are we to see the president deal with this? And by president dealing with this, I mean that he's spoken about
if you expect
he's
to see
told
the president,
he's told the IGP to act. And I say that we have a national security coordinator, we have a minister for national security, we have a minister for interior, a minister for defense.
I don't expect you to think that any of these individuals is going to go there and arrest the people themselves.
Well,
so once the president himself has indicated and they're also doing their job, the police will do their work. And for example, taking the case of Kumasi, what happened? Yes, maybe some people did not see action. But it turned out that, yes, the police were acting. People had been arrested. People had been detained. And investigations were ongoing. So the fact that maybe you may not have seen...
The videos we saw, Mr. Langton, were more than 45. Look at the numbers there on your screen. And 15 people were picked up.
You see...
In fact, three of them had to turn themselves in, actually.
Well...
The police were there. They came there. They actually had to whisk... The president's appointee.
But I see that is one thing. The other thing is that the issue must be able to stand up in law. The police must be able to actually grab somebody. There must be a report. There must be evidence. There must be witnesses to say, yes, there was a crowd there. We all agree. We saw the crowd. Like it happens in many situations. But when it comes to actual arrests, who do you arrest? Do you go looking for another crowd of people to arrest? Or do you? So it's not as simple as that. The police are doing their professional job. Let us give them their due. At the end of the day, the admonition of the Nigerian professor, I'm sure we've all, we know what it is, and there is no way that under the watch of His Excellency, such a situation.
They're becoming one too many, aren't they?
You know, I must say that, of course, nobody's going to be happy hearing that something like this has happened. Yes, it has happened. But the comfort and the satisfaction we should all have is that it is being dealt with at the highest levels. So it's not something that should be... It's not like there's some sporadic indiscipline going on in the country where there's chaos in Ghana. No.
Elijah, of that sort. Do you see action? Are you feeling it?
Well, not really. However, we must... anyway, good morning to your cherished listeners and especially my constituents in Zabzu and around the northern sector. Yes, it's first and foremost, I think we need to applaud the president for being the first person to say that the buck stops with me and it must stop. On the other hand, you have leaders of MPP, maybe sponsors, coming out to threaten government that if anything happened to this vigilante group, because we paid and sponsored them.
What are you referring to at this point?
Well, several news articles came out.
No, but you are a legend, so you must prove.
Well, I must prove. I don't have a news article here, but we saw one.
But you can remember a name, at least.
One, a colleague MP, saying that.
What's his name, sir?
Ken.
Okay.
Saying that government cannot, there are videos on it, playing, saying that, no, he's even warned the minister that he cannot do any arrest. Well, we have seen these things around. Having said that, vigilante groups, they are all over the world.
Okay.
But when it starts taxing and you don't rule, you don't whip, it turns into chaos. Nigeria, Boko Haram. It started somewhere in the 90s. And there were politicians supporting it.
The government did not act.
Government did not act.
Yes, that's the difference.
Today we have a problem. No, you said that's the difference, but we are still taxing towards Boko Haram.
I am worried because both the NDC and the MPP are known to have vigilante groups. The Zorka Boys, the Bamba Boys, the Invisible Forces, the Delta Forces. We both know around this table that these are groups that support or have a lineage or linkage to the political parties that we belong to.
But you can attest to the fact that the Azoka Boys, if it exists,
it is not about.
Please, we are talking about the principle.
It is not about the principle.
It is not about. It is not about the lesser of two evils.
Exactly.
It is about a complete evil.
The complete evil is that we don't need vigilante groups. Yes, parties need some support during elections to provide, guidance and protection of ballot boxes to give pronouncement,
So what would be the essence of the security? Because I remember in the last election in 2016, IGP John Kudalo said they were going to disband all these vigilante groups and actually provide security for all. And in fact, the candidates had a chance to choose among a pool of security personnel who would guard them and ensure their safety. So what is the essence of a vigilante group?
Well, it's not the parties coming out to give vigilante group, but individuals. Individuals, as we just, as I mentioned, a colleague just exemplified that he paid and sponsored them.
No, but if a colleague, a colleague of yours, member of parliament, or whoever, has said something like this, and yet no other person than the first person, gentleman, the president, commander-in-chief, has said something contrary. Does that mean that the party is supporting? In every situation, you might have one or two people whose views might be a little different. So therefore, may say things that might sound as though they are supporting something or might want to justify something. It does not mean that the party supports it. The president himself has said it. He has, and I thank you for reminding me again, that he himself has said that the buck stops with him. And he is going to make sure. What more confidence do you want?
We wish him well.
Yes. So, as the president of the republic,
we can say that we wish him well. While
no, he knows that the job of the president is.
The president has issued a statement and want to see actions.
Action is on course.
Are we seeing action? I can't see action.
The fact that you are not seeing does not mean it's not happening.
Well, I need to see to believe. Seeing is believing.
My brother, the fact that your viewers I'm not seeing the hard work of technical people are doing behind the scenes. It doesn't mean that's not happening.
Well, at the end of the day, we roll end credits. So,
well, they might not be seeing it now.
So they
might not be seeing
it
now.
Really.
At the end of the day, they'll see the credits.
But this is a very serious matter.
We have NHI being locked up by special forces.
Exactly.
We have Delta Force. We have Azorka Boy. Kandahar, ruling Tamale. And you see, everywhere you have these vigilante groups, all of them belong to MPP.
It is not about, I don't believe in the finger pointing. I'm looking for a holistic solution to this problem.
And that is the way the president is even tackling it. The president says it should never happen again.
The president has called, but when will the IGP act? That's my problem.
He's acting.
How?
He's acting.
See the action.
No, but interview the police and find out what they've done so far. They are acting. The same way people said the police were not acting until it came out about the actions they are taking in Kumasi. That's why I'm reminding you, my brother, that the fact that you may not see certain things in action now, and you say you're going to wait till the end of the credits, it's the same situation. It's happening. You're not seeing it. So you want to wait till the end of the credits before you see that, after all, the police were working.
Okay.
So you relax. The police are doing their job.
I see. Let's move on, and you can join the conversation. If you're seeing action about the vigilante groups, join us. WhatsApp 050-823-5228. That's 050-823-5228. Also on Twitter at News on TV3. Let's move on to Galamse. We're told by most of the papers this morning that Galamse is a killer, Galamse is this, Galamse is that. Are we winning the fight against Galamse? The minister is giving an ultimatum, hopefully some 12, 13 days more to the end of the ultimatum. The media has launched a big campaign to combat it, and all the president said it's a complex issue. But what solutions are available to us, Mr. Langton?
Well, my brother, it's not easy. It's a national problem, major national problem that threatens to cause major problems for all of us.
Right.
We are having problems. I heard, I think was it Honorable Dr. Ada the other time, giving some very scary statistics about how difficult it might get for us to even get clean, hygienic, fresh water
right.
piped to us because it's becoming increasingly, first of all, increasingly expensive to process the water, and it's even getting very difficult to get access to the water, even the raw hard water to process for domestic and industrial use. So that is a major problem that I'm saying. It is destroying all our farmlands,
okay.
our cocoa areas. A lot of lands under which it was under cocoa cultivation. It's now under Galamse.
Yeah.
Everything is threatened. Schools are threatened. Cemeteries are threatened. Everywhere is threatened. Mm-hmm. It's a major environmental disaster. And it is reaching certain alarming levels. Mm-hmm. If you go to certain areas, eastern, central region, I mean, which areas that I myself have seen, it's scary. You don't see, the rivers have changed color. And it's not like some mud that you expect that in time will settle. It has become a permanent coloration of the water. It cannot sustain any marine life.
Aquatic life.
Nothing. I mean, it is serious and it's dangerous. It's a problem, hydro-headed problem, that has faced this country for years. But thankfully now, what we see, there is an interministerial task force that is working
We've seen that before.
You see that before. The fact that you've seen me before doesn't necessarily mean that. the same thing. You may have seen that. You may have seen that before under a different government. Mm. But the resolve and determination of this government. Mm. I mean, the speed with which action is being taken. You know, and let me also commend the media partners. I haven't seen TV3 in that partnership though.
We're taking a lead in that actually.
So you agree with me that the fact that you may have seen something that doesn't necessarily mean
we actually started that campaign. We're there.
So you understand how it goes.
No,
very well. The point is, the kind of resolve and commitment that is being demonstrated to fight Galamse. It is being tackled from all angles. We have to, first of all, begin to even conscientize our people to appreciate that, look, the problem isn't just about you trying to fish out and get some gold residue for your own immediate economic welfare. Mm. But you are doing something that has a very long-term, seriously damaging catastrophe.
And at this point, because you're a member of the MPP and part of their communications team, the minister says there's an ultimatum. At the end of the ultimatum, what are we to see?
The minister has his own roadmap. He's given an ultimatum. The minister is not somebody, if you know him well, he's not somebody who can sit down and say, I've given an ultimatum. You sit down, fold his arms and wait for the deadline to come up. Like I'm saying, there's an interministerial task force. Right. It is all tied in with the ultimatum he's given. There are other actions that have been taken. There's a security agencies too are also doing their own arrangements. It's all going to be coordinated so that we're not going to have the, as it were, the kind of situations we had in the past where you see some ad hoc things being done. It is being tackled holistically. And I'm very happy that, you know, the media partners have come on board. And also, in the collaboration of the Ministry of Information and the Minister, Mustafa, is also, you know, being a part of this task force and also an interministerial task force. You know, because the Ministry of Information is also there.
So by the end of the ultimatum, we will see that licenses have been suspended.
No, but my brother, you know, we
will see
already licenses have been suspended. As we speak, some, not licenses, small scale licenses have been suspended. Because we got to a point where some of these small scale licenses they've lost control.
Well, the question, and I'll come to Alaji shortly, but the challenge, the real big challenge is that it's not about the small-scale licenses.
Yes.
It's about those who go for prospective licenses for large-scale mining, who go there and actually, because they have the concession, they go to now divide the land into small portions and give to small-scale guys to do the mining.
Yeah.
So if we're banning small-scale mining licenses, we really may not be solving the problem.
See, it's just two things. Galamse as an operation, even if you have a license to do underground mining, large-scale underground mining, and you are doing Galamse, we're not going to say because your license is for large-scale mining, so we're not going to mind you. It is the activity that is the focus of the problem.
Okay.
Suspending the licenses is just, it's just one of the activities to tackle and deal with that problem. So it is being handled holistically.
Right.
The problem is that the way these people are handling, it's that the major look at what Professor Prinfon Bati was saying. It is already beginning to affect our relationship with our neighboring sister country, Cote d'Ivoire. already we are very amicably sorting out our border dispute issues, this thing can jeopardize it.
There's a collection of 1 million petitioners.
Yes.
Are you feeling the pressure? Is the MPP government feeling the pressure?
Oh, it is not a matter of MPP feeling the pressure. MPP is championing the process.
Which one? Process.
Well, of ending Galamsey.
Alaj, I'll pick your thoughts now. Are you feeling the pressure? Your government tried to solve this.
Exactly.
But we didn't see much of action in that direction.
Well, I think
the drones that are now being introduced was introduced by your government.
Exactly.
We had a whole military move there under President Mills, and yet the thing has continued. It's worsened now.
Well, but I think that we've done it before.
Yes.
And if you look at it, we need to now think outside the box.
What do we need by that?
Well, if you look at the land tenure system in the country, it's the main cause of this catastrophic economic disaster or land degradation facing us now. And it has to look at, we have to look at it differently. My opinion, this is not my party opinion. My opinion is that we will have to rethink, probably do some study to see the acquisition or the taking back of all lands back to state and invest it in state so that state can control it.
The Aborigines Right Protection Society back then
didn't
agree with this philosophy.
But this is what we have run into, whereby landowners, petty landowners or still lands decide to make economic benefits by selling out land or giving out land to small-scale miners. And so
I don't think that is entirely fair to say that, because the Minerals Commission, the EPA, they grant these licenses with the signature of the minister and some big man somewhere. The prospectors take it to the village and show the chief that this is a signature. What is the chief to do?
No.
It's deeper than that. It's the land. Getting licensed. It's just like you go to register your company. If I go to register my company, I register general to do business.
Right.
Register general give me commencement license and certificate to do business. Now, it is left on to me to go and cite my business.
Absolutely.
And conduct my business. Now, that is where the problem is. The problem is not about the Minerals Commission, but it comes from where do these people go to get the land?
They are the regulators. EPA, Minerals Commission, are they not the regulators? Are they not the ones supposed to be regulating
the
activities?
Do they go to look at the land
but
these people mine?
No, this is a question.
You see, do they go to mine? If, let's go back to what I was suggesting. If the state takes back this land, they would be able to do something called zoning.
Okay.
And then they can zone the land to say that this area is for this mining, this area is for this farming, assuming, mining is profitable to government.
How well have we done with zoning, even in Accra, where we have fuel stations sited right in the heart of residential areas?
So, now you are back to
So this zoning thing, really,
you are back to what I was saying.
I don't buy that idea.
No, you are back to what I was saying. Take your car, drive around Accra, and you see that the places where the land in Accra itself, where you have planning, that means that it's, in the 60s and 70s. Right. Beyond that, you'll be driving to dead end and be driving to homes.
Right.
Just because the land has been sold by landowners. It's two landowners.
There's a fundamental point of departure. The suggestion my brother is making here. I mean, from my own profession, I understand him entirely.
Okay.
And, I can agree with him. But the problem is that that approach doesn't solve the problem.
What approach was
we are dealing with an activity that is criminal, but in the legal context, it's a criminal activity fueled by a certain economic need of the people.
Right.
You have AGC, or former AGC, Ashanti Gold. They had a hard time getting people off their concession issues.
Right.
It had nothing to do with people having prospective licenses, people have smoking licenses. These were people who had just grown encroaching. The people, it's like this Fulani herdsmen. Right. The people who are going onto people's farms and doing the garamsi, what they do is they actually go onto the land. Then when the farmer starts to complain, when the chief starts to complain, say, you know something, how much is your crops? You know something, you hold this in the meantime. Okay. And then they are working. Meanwhile, the chief, his some of his subjects who are unemployed, tell them, you know something, if they come and work for me, they'll get 20 cedis a day, 30 cedis a day. So the chief said, well, my cocoa is not, my farm is not doing so well. The rains haven't fallen. So if somebody has given me an economic opportunity, he goes for it. And so that is why we have had a difficulty in dealing with this matter.
So now the people are saying, until you implement the one district, one factory, don't come chasing them.
No. That does not come before the other. They cannot. You see, the issue of Galamsey is not something anybody can give any government. And of course, with the new Patriotic Party, nobody can come and give conditions under which Galamsey should be stopped.
Is that a promise?
I like that.
No, but that is the attitude of the part of the government. Right.
Well, you the promise government them, is you promise with them it. One factor, one. You promise
but
them a lot.
My
of,
brother,
you gave them a lot of promises.
No. You please, please. It. One district, one factory. And I tell you, I know a
and
bit
one
about
dam,
that. I
one
know
village.
A bit about that, my brother. You don't open one factory in one district like opening a kiosk at the. Mm. We are working on it, and the amount of work that is going on. Mm. Anyway, me, I say, okay. That's
so
another matter.
So
we'll leave it for
so
the interview.
Yes,
we'll
I do know that you know, when you are setting a factory, you need to look at the raw materials and, and market.
Exactly.
When we already have the plans.
Whether you
well,
consider
when
all
we already
those
have the plans.
Whether you consider
back,
all those things.
Let's come back to the Galamsey issue. Yes. There's one angle that I want us to expect. Kitech. They trade in earth moving equipment. Yeah. They've given the Ghana Police Service some 50,000 Ghana cedis donation. The Immigration Service got an equal measure of 50,000 Ghana cedis. These two agencies are the ones that we have started this campaign and we expect them to front us to go drive these people away. Kitech may not necessarily be included in mining, but they may be selling earth moving equipment or they may be buying the gold after it's been mined. Do you think
are they gold buyers as well?
I don't know. I'm just saying, earth moving. But yeah. So the rationale behind this question is: should the police return the money because the public say it will influence them negatively?
Personally, I don't see any link between the company or whatever they have offered. They've offered to the police in their fight against
the timing.
Well, you know, my brother. I don't see a direct link. The police has, somebody has gone, that is my personal opinion.
Okay.
The police is in need of funds and somebody has offered them some funds.
I thought the state provided for the police.
The state has always provided for the police
so
from
why the
time
need,
immemorial.
So why the need for...
And the police service of Ghana from time immemorial has appreciated and continues to appreciate the support of individuals and corporate bodies and even societies and groups.
Some say
so
we should have a private fund where you want to give to the police, go and drop it, no names attached, no strings attached, so we can assess the fund. Is that a workable plan?
That's another suggestion.
Is it a workable plan?
It's another suggestion.
Is it a workable plan?
Some people giving, you see, you look at it seriously. When people are giving donations to the police service or any other group, there are various reasons why they do it. One, they want to demonstrate a certain public service.
Right. But here the people are not happy about this donation.
Wow. I mean, you see, I've heard people being unhappy for many reasons. What I don't like is stereotyping. Some people say, oh, these people are Chinese and they are paying this money, so we should reject it. Because they are Chinese? Or what? That's argument I don't take. If the company is donating and there is no direct link.
It is not just the company. It is the Chinese societies in Ghana. We know the role they play in Galamsey.
That is also another thing that we must stop. The other day, some people went and attacked Nigerians in South Africa.
Okay.
People have been attacked. Stereotyping is wrong. There are so many Chinese nationals in Ghana. The Chinese government is one of the biggest supporters of our economy.
Right.
So China happens to be the biggest country on earth. So if it has the biggest population as well, if there are some Chinese nationals who are committing a crime or who are doing something illegal, let us deal with it. Like you see on the front page of the statement, some Ghanaians and some Chinese, well, they've arrested 7 people.
Okay. Only 7?
Well, there was an exercise where 7 individuals were arrested.
Okay.
So many groups of people are being arrested. Mm. On the TV yesterday, I saw Greater Accra Regional Police have arrested about a gang of about 12 or 15 people. They all happen to be Ghanaians. They are arresting people. Now, when they arrest the people and they find that some are Ghanaians, some are Nigerians, some are Chinese or whatever, that is a different matter.
Okay.
But for us to try and brand some people because of their nationality, I think it's wrong.
Stereotyping is wrong.
It's not about stereotyping.
I'm coming to the evidence
on the face of the pink sheet.
Exactly. No. But I'm
consistently
providing further and better particulars.
Exactly.
You know, let me come here. You know, stereotyping is wrong.
Right.
The other day, I was reading the news and I saw that people, some company or some party approaches, were telling the police to return the money. Now, the only word I didn't like was Chinese.
Yes.
But to return the money. And so.
So you are for returning the money?
No. I'm against the returning of the money.
Why?
But you know.
Why?
The line I saw.
Why are you against the
returning? No. Let me be a little mischievous here, but factual. What I wanted to say is that, return the money. Now you think it is good time for MPP to return the money, but when the Vice President Bawumia went to China.
That is not the conversation.
No, it is a conversation because today you think that Chinese money is not good. If you think Chinese money was good, but yesterday Chinese money was good, we will go to that angle. I said I need to be factual, but a little mischievous.
Specifically, this 50,000, that's what we're talking about now. Should the money be returned?
No.
Okay.
But what the police must do now is that the police administration must set up a fund probably for destitute, people harm, working and being harmed on the duty and other things, so that benevolent and people and society and companies can donate.
Okay.
When you donate your money, it doesn't go to the police administration.
Okay.
They put the money in there instead of the police administration taking the money because it brings conflict of interest.
Finally, on this matter, there's also the angle of ammunition. And each time some galamseyers are arrested, you find that they have guns, small weapons and rifles and what have you. Every single time.
Illegally or registered?
Well, I don't know, but they have the guns and they are ready to shoot. The owners of some farms that we spoke with say they are encroaching on their farms, they go to them and then they point guns at them. That's a big national security issue, isn't it?
It is. It is we can't allow our national security to break down to such level. Provided the guns are licensed. And even if they are licensed, that comes back to the issue of this land ownership and the regulations of lands. Mm. Who should and when should you sell your land for such activity and why? Who must approve it? What are the checks for you to sell this land? I think we need to do a serious review to look at it. Yeah, though it's economic importance, to both the landowner and the person also mining and create jobs. However, we must be careful in the way we do, go about this. Mr.
London, you want to have a bite
of
this?
No, you see, we sometimes try to lose the argument. I mean, the Ghana Police Service has always received support. And will continue to receive support.
That's not, we have moved on. We're talking about ammunition now, Mr. London.
Well, you see, the issue of ammunition, there are two things. Like my brother said, if somebody has a legally registered weapon and he's not using for anything illegal, that's fine. Sometimes, some people may be holding their weapons to defend themselves against some level of criminality because they happen to be in an outlandish area or some remote area. That's another matter. These issues must be dealt with on their own merit.
Okay.
On the legal.
In this instance, Galamsey is legal.
Galamsey is illegal.
And they are policing their.
You see, my brother has given some very, with all due respect, academic and very intelligent solutions to the problem.
Right.
But the truth of the matter is that the matter is not that way.
Okay.
You have people who have their farms. Mm. The farm is not doing so well. He is going out there, he travels. From his farm, he goes to a village somewhere and goes and sees the Chinese people that do. My farm, I'm not getting. Come and see if you get.
Okay. You looked for something there.
That is the problem we have. Okay. So when anything, the regulations should be there. That is why we have, we are approaching this matter from a multi-sectoral point of view. Already, there's a major consultation going on to try and let the people appreciate that, look, it is not about your immediate
gains,
benefits. Mm-hmm. That
they must begin to feel and appreciate that, look, this thing we are doing, it is not, it might not hurt us now, but it is going to hurt our children. But see, sometimes trying to convince such people is a bit difficult because they want to just see about just their immediate future. They are not prepared to appreciate anything that goes. Like, try to explain to somebody that my friend take time and go to school. He said, why? I need the money. I need to go and train right now.
Yeah, let's wrap up. Alaji, I'll have some very final thoughts on this one. NDC's broken car, says Dr. Spio Gabra, says the shocks need to be fixed. Is the NDC a broken car, as Dr. Spio Gabra says?
That's his opinion. But I don't think
NDC. What's your opinion?
I don't think the NDC is a broken car.
It is not a broken car.
It is just a car that has come to a halt. It is a car that has come to a halt.
At a mechanic shop?
No. Not at a mechanic shop. Okay. Just taking a rest.
Okay.
And it's going to be refuel and move.
But at this point, we need it's the going to be refuel. Active, not to be taking a rest.
You know, you have to remember that this is not the first time NDC has lost power. This is not the first time. Okay. And so for it is neither here or there for people saying NDC is broken, car is not going to move again, the party is going to be disintegrated and all this. No.
The grassroots are not happy about your misfortune.
Of course, the grassroots is not happy because they are out of power. Mm. But we will get power. In 4 years' time.
I see.
Look at all the promises. Look at all the promises MPP made. Mm. Taxes, spare parts, everything they are not, you know. And look, they will take rob Peter to pay Paul. Mm. Nothing.
Okay.
So in 4 years' time, you will see that one will refuel, will take off.
So now there's no fuel in the car. The car is taking a break because
the car
no fuel.
Yes, but we are fueling. We are buying fuel.
Okay, sure. Thank you. Mr. Philip Landon.
Oh, I like the way.
You like the way they are buying fuel. Yes, yes. It's resting.
The car is broken.
Once upon a time, your car was broken down too.
Our
it was
car
resting. What was it?
Our car, but in their case, the car has stopped.
Okay.
He says it's a fuel situation.
Yeah. What do you see? What do you see?
The car is broken.
It's broken.
Yes.
Okay.
And it's broken not because maybe the fuel pipe is not flowing or the tank.
Okay.
The axle is broken. So the car is.
How can the axle be broken?
They need
how can the axle be broken?
Truck to come and lift the car. Take it to.
Will you give them a tow truck?
No, the tow truck they need. We don't have some.
Alaji Umar Alassan is the MP of Zabzugu. Thank you for coming, Alaji.
Grateful.
Mr. Philip Landon is a member of the MPP and with their communications team as well. Gentlemen, thank you very much. Grateful for your
pleasure.
And for you, keep watching.